afternoon, everyone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. As it was mentioned today, this Sunday, we celebrate the feast of the Epiphany, which is the revelation of the child Jesus to the Gentiles. We're still on the octave of Christmas, so we must still feel the spirit of Christmas, which is hope, peace, and joy. Brothers and sisters, as we celebrate this wonderful gift of the sacrament, let us call to mind our sins and be sorry for them. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. God, who on this day revealed your only begotten Son to the nations by the guidance of a star, grant in your mercy that we who know you already by faith may be brought to behold the beauty of your sublime glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Rise up in splendor, Jerusalem. Your light has come. The glory of the Lord shines upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick clouds cover the peoples. But upon you the Lord shines, and over you appears his glory. Nations shall walk by your light, and kings by your shining radiance. Raise your eyes and look about. They all gather and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters in the arms of their nurses. Then you shall be radiant at what you see. Your heart shall throb and overflow, for the riches of the sea shall be emptied out before you. The wealth of nations shall be brought to you. Caravans of camels shall fill you, dromedaries from Midian and Ephah. All from Sheba shall come, bearing gold and frankincense, and proclaiming the praises of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, you have heard the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for your benefit. Namely, that the mystery was made known to me by revelation. It was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, and co-partners in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, behold, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We saw his star at its rising, and have come to do him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was greatly troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it has been written through the prophets, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, since from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod called the Magi secretly and ascertained from them the time of the star's appearance. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search diligently for the child. When you have found him, bring me word, that I too may go and do him homage.' After their audience with the king, they set out. And behold, the star that they had seen at its rising preceded them until it came and stopped over the place where the child was. They were overjoyed at seeing the star, and on entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. They prostrated themselves and did him homage. Then they opened their treasures and offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed for their country by another way." My dear friends, the Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated for a while. Well, we're still in the octave of Christmas, so much so that I hope and pray that we still have that spirit in our hearts, the spirit of joy being with Jesus in our midst, knowing that we have now a God who is among us, a God who is not so distant, a God who is not invisible, but a God who is concrete and who is dwelling among us. We have marveled with some different events before we finally celebrated the birth of the Lord last week. And the feast that we celebrate today, which we call the Epiphany, is still part of those series of events that made up of the whole season of Christmas. That is to say, that the feast of Epiphany is still part of the mystery of the Incarnation. And as we are coming close and closer and closer to the conclusion of the Christmas season, we are still being given the opportunity to still dwell and reflect on the beauty of the birth of the Lord as witnessed by different people. As we now celebrate the Epiphany, which is the revelation of the baby Jesus to the Gentiles. Who are these Gentiles? These wise men. These men who came from the east, who spent days in journey in a very uncomfortable travel, only to really find and search for Jesus. And understanding the message of the feast is to avoid paying attention to the wrong issues, because the key in understanding the feast is to focus on the characters that are involved in the story and not the star of Bethlehem. And reading or listening to the gospel narrative this Sunday, or just the narrative that you have just heard, we can find out that there are two groups of people or characters mentioned in the gospel narrative. The first group of people is represented by the wise men from the east. You know, before we call this Three Kings, remember when we were much, much older, we celebrated on the January 6th, the Feast of the Three Kings. And I hope that everybody knows why we now call it the Feast of the Epiphany, for so many reasons. First, the church says we're not even sure if there are only three of them. Second, if we celebrate the Feast of the Three Kings, then we are not really celebrating the real reason why the visit is made. So the church calls this feast the Feast of the Epiphany, or the manifestation of the child Jesus with the wise men. These wise men are called the Gentiles, who represent the non-Jew all over the world. And as I said, we can truly understand the story by not focusing on the wrong issue. It's not the star of Bethlehem, but these people, these men who traveled from far away land. They were not born and bred within the tradition and beliefs of Israel. Because as we always hear, Israel is the chosen race. But look at these men. They got the opportunity to spend time in travel in search of the baby, even if they're not part of the tradition and beliefs of Israel. They do not form a part of the chosen people, as I said, as they represent all of us here. We are non-Jews, we are Gentiles. And these men represent, you know, all people all over the world. However, even if they were not part of the chosen race, if they are not part of the tradition or the Israel, they respond to the sign in heaven marking the birth of a great king, and they came to pay him homage. You could just imagine the travel that they had to endure, you know, the cold weather while traveling, the inconvenience of traveling, you know, using animal. Unlike now, we enjoy travel because we are, you know, riding in cars or in airplanes or in trains. But before, you know, they travel sometimes barefooted or sometimes by the use of animals. So we can just imagine how inconvenient the process was. They were filled with delight, first and foremost. They were so happy. And upon seeing the baby, they fell on their knees and offered him their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. You know, these gifts represent, you know, the identity of Christ. Because gold means that the baby is king. Frankincense, because Jesus is divine. And myrrh, to signify that while the baby is divine, he is also human. So the gold, the frankincense, and the myrrh represent the identity of the baby Jesus. And eventually, you know, upon the visit after the visit is made and concluded, they respond to the Lord's warning in a dream about Herod, and they return to their countries by a different way. You know, because Herod has a bad plan. This particular plan causes, you know, the death of innocent babies. You know. Well, the second group of people, as we know, represented by Herod, the interpreters of the scriptures, and the people of Jerusalem. The interpreters of scriptures are the scribes. The scribes are the experts of the laws of the scriptures. And the story of the joyful and positive response from the wise man is matched by the opposite reaction from those who should have known better. Imagine being experts of the scriptures. They know about the signs. They can tell where the baby is going to be born. But they were not open to the grace and revelation of God. The scribes and the chief priests are the people from whom the wise men asked for informations, since they know what the scriptures say about the baby. They know the answer, as I have mentioned, of the sacred tradition, but they are not open to the revelation of God, which will take place in the child who is going to be born as king. Herod and the whole Jerusalem were perturbed. Their insecurities and unwillingness to accept the revelation, you know, eventually leads to the slaying of the innocent babies. Because of Herod's insecurities, because of Herod's envy and jealousy, they have made an order, you know, because he was not able to find the child. Kill all the babies that were born during this time. Today, the church proclaims the revelation of God to the whole world as a child is worshipped by the wise men from the east. Now, the question is, in what group can we identify ourselves? Can we identify ourselves with the wise men from the east, who are willing to go out of their comfort zones just to find a baby? It's a good question, because sometimes when we are already complacent, we do not want to do something else. Oh, I'm okay with here. I'm okay here. I'm comfortable. And we are not willing to venture into the unknown, into the unfamiliar. But look at these men. They were also probably head of their countries. These men probably belong to the highest status of society, but they had to go out of their comfort zones because they believed in the signs that they have seen in the heavens. Or can we identify ourselves to the opposite group led by Herod, who were so preoccupied with his own concerns such that he failed to recognize the revelation of God? During this Christmas season, how many hours have we spent in our spiritual preparation versus the hours we spend in material and physical preparation? How many hours have we spent going to the stores or to the malls buying stuff? And think about how many hours have I spent in prayers because I am excited for the birth of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, we still have 1 week to enjoy the season of Christmas. And during this time, we can still have the opportunity to reflect on this wonderful grace of being close to God. Imagine the mystery of incarnation has been unfolded and we witness the revelation of the Father in the person of Jesus. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. Having seen the light of Christ, we come to do him homage. Let us pray to him with confidence.
For all who share the gospel of Christ, that their lives serve as a model of justice and holiness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations, that they ensure religious freedom for all their citizens, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we recognize this new year as an opportunity to grow closer to Christ and to serve one another, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the hungry and the poor be cared for and supported by the followers of the light of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the sick and dying among us, for those we serve through our parish ministries, and all who have asked for our prayer, that they may find comfort, peace, and strength in God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we remember those who have died, our loved ones who have gone before us, and those who mourn the loss of someone dear to them. We remember especially Juan Aguilar, Barbara Hurst, Javier Salazar, and Esmeralda Reyes, rest in peace, for whom this Mass is offered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers. In silence, let us pray for our personal intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Wondrous God, you look with love on your creation. Bless us and those we love. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of the name, for the good of all this holy church.
Let us pray. Look with favor, Lord, we pray, on these gifts of your church, in which are offered now not gold or frankincense or myrrh, but he who by them is proclaimed, sacrificed and received, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through him the holy exchange that restores our life has shone forth today in splendor. When our frailty is assured by your word, not only does human mortality receive unending honor, but by this wondrous union we too are made eternal. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you and with joy we proclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and bless your resurrection until you come again. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and bless your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
With hearts filled with joy as one community, let us call on the Father through the very words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power,
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you all. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. just to be more protected against the virus, I would suggest everybody to sanitize our hands before coming inside the church. Coming in and out, we can sanitize our hands and also wear our masks. So this is for our protection. So we don't need to, you know, fear about contagion. And we pray that this pandemic may come to an end and we live a normal lives, especially with our sacramental lives together. Let us pray. Go before us with heavenly light, O Lord, always and everywhere, that we may perceive with clear sight and revere with true affection the mystery in which you have willed us to participate through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.
You also, Father.
Thank you.